Hey guys, back with another rapid game on Lee Chess facing, yikes, I'm not even going to try that name actually, facing cplyakap1905, and, I'm going to play the Grunfeld. I play the King's Indian a lot, but I've been looking to make the switch to the Grunfeld. That is an interesting choice. that is not a normal Grunfeld option, but okay. So presumably, just bishop g7 is fine. And as is always customary in the Grunfeld, you're just looking for c5 at some point. I don't see any maybe there is some reason why I might want to play c5 before I castle. So if I go castles, maybe he can go queen c2, and after c5, he can go bishop c4. And that's probably not even bad, but after queen d6, he does gain the option of pushing his d-pawn. Whereas if I go c5 now, he doesn't have that option. He can play like bishop b5 check, but I really don't even think I care. Probably I can just go bishop d7 or knight c6, so I'm going to do this. I feel pretty okay about my position thus far. Yeah, like I said, I'm trying to play the opening a little bit quicker in these games just because sometimes I explain all of these options and I end up in severe time trouble later, but I will discuss on my opponent's turn. It's much more common for white to go e4 here. And after e4, knight takes c3, b takes c3, bishop g7, you reach the exchange variation of the Grunfeld proper, and black will try to lay waste to these pawns on in the center, but okay. So interesting, he's taking this. Highly tempting as queen takes d1, just bungling up his king and hoping to pick up this c5 pawn later. I have to think about this for a second. So if I go queen takes d1, king takes d1, knight b to d7, he can go bishop b5, castles, maybe he can take on d7. That's possible. I'm not even certain that's really all that bad, but it might be, you know, that doesn't even look that bad to me. I can also just castle first. So queen takes d1, king takes d1, castles, and knight d7 to follow. He can attempt to protect the pawn by bishop two and bishop d2 and rook c1, but anytime he goes bishop d2, I'm going to take on b2. So I think I'm going to play this. This seems principled, and I'll castle. And someone's sending me a hangout message. Still working all the kinks out of streaming here. for instance, not closing Google Hangouts, not putting my phone on mute. But that's okay. I feel like it adds a little bit of extra flavor to my videos. I'll be known as that incompetent guy who doesn't quite do things the right way. I like the Grunfeld. I play a lot of one knight f3 and g3, bishop g2 is white, and then go d4 down the road a little bit, and a lot of those positions like the Catalan or some of the other positions you reach out of that structure are a little bit Grunfeld-esque, so I feel at home here. I've been struggling with the King's Indian a little bit lately. This looks risky. So white is already quite a bit behind in development, and his king is stuck on d1, and he's moving the same piece again. I mean, right away I can play bishop takes d4, e takes d4, rook d8. And if bishop e3, I can just go knight c6, and I'm at least winning my pawn back. I'm a little reluctant to give up this bishop, though. Presumably he wants to put the knight on b3 and hold on to his pawn. I think that's his plan. Go rook d8 right away, threatening e5. And if he moves his king, let's say to e1, I can either just take or maybe even knight c6. And if knight takes c6, b takes c6, that feels... still feels like black has a lot of compensation there. All of my pieces will come to very active squares. Bishop e6, bishop f5, rook a to b8. Kind of calling my name. Knight d4 seems really odd. I'm not certain. Yeah, I mean, what's more natural than rook d8? So let's go rook d8. See what happens. This is an odd opening play by my opponent here. So he goes bishop d2. Now it's tempting to just go... I mean, I can just win my pawn back, but maybe that's not even the best I can do. So if just like knight c6 is kind of calling my name. I'm just trying to develop as fast as humanly possible and catch his king in the crossfire here. So if knight c6, what's he doing? Bishop c3, I go e5, so that would be terrible. That would win a piece. Knight c6, knight takes c6, b takes c6. Threatening bishop takes b2, rook b1, bishop c3, that would win a piece. What does he do about that? King c1, perhaps, but then I can play bishop takes b2, king takes b2, rook takes d2, and then rook takes f2. That would be quite bad. That position looks just bad for white. Not good. So, what else could he play instead of knight takes c6? Knight b5, perhaps? But any knight move, I at least just get to take on b2. Worst case scenario. I mean, after knight b5, knight c6, knight b5, I can even just continue to develop. Bishop f5 would very seriously threaten bishop takes b2, for instance. I'm going to go knight c6, I think. Is e5 anything? e5, knight b3? Yeah, no, I don't think so. So I'll pre-move b takes c6. I recorded, like, I mentioned this in my last video. I recorded it really, like, because I sort of anticipated next weekend that I won't be able to really record, and I'll be in Cincinnati that weekend, and sometimes during the week I just have other stuff going on, or, you know, I don't feel like doing a lot of chess when I get home if I'm really tired from work or whatever. So I recorded like four videos yesterday, and like two or three of them were marred by mic troubles. I complained a little bit. So he goes king c1, but I thought just bishop b2 here, and he's in a world of hurt. Is there anything better? Rook b8 even? Maybe rook b8, bishop c3 is possible, though. Rook d2. No, that's just worse. It's just a pretty simple tactic. And his, I mean, he's not even out of the woods with regards to king safety yet either. His king is still kind of a mess. Still hasn't got most of his pieces off their original squares, so this looks pretty bad. And I'll just take on f2, I think. And we bag a pawn, so that's good. But yeah, I had a ton of these games recorded, and some of them were marred by me accidentally putting my mic on mute. Kind of embarrassing and also quite unfortunate. So he wants to go rook d8. I don't feel as though I should probably allow that. So what should I play here? Bishop f5, bishop e6 are the most natural moves. Kind of thinking I like bishop f5 just because it looks a little bit more harmonious with my rook on f2. And a2 is still hanging. If he moves the bishop, g2 is hanging. Hmm. I'll just play bishop f5. So I'm being very careful not to touch my mic. Let's turn on the chat room, see if he said anything. No. Bishop c4. Can I win that guy? Rook c2, king b3, rook b8 check. That looks to win a piece. Rook c2, king d4, rook d8. Sort of feel like black's losing that bishop, but I could be wrong. So if rook c2 check, king b4, so the lines I'm considering, rook c2 check, king b3, rook b8. He has to go to one of these two squares, and I just simply take this thing. He's got nothing. So rook c2, king d4 here. I mean, geez. King e5, rook takes d1, rook takes d1, rook takes c2. So this just looks completely winning. Yeah. An unfortunate square for the bishop. But white was in a lot of trouble anyway. I think objectively his position is their position. I need to get used to when... Okay, so he just resigns. I need to get used to when streaming just... you know what? Let's offer a rematch. That game was so short. I'll play a second one. I'll offer a rematch. And he accepts. So we'll analyze both after the game's finish. Oh, interesting. So, of course, black wants to go e5. I'll play d4, and presumably we'll get a Chigorin's defense. You know what? I'm gonna avoid c4 for the time being, and I'm going to play g3. This is a way. Interesting. So this is kind of wacky now. Now I'm thinking about c4, because if d takes c4 now, then I can go d5 and boot his knight to a weird square. So in that case, man, knight f3, knight c6. You don't see that every day. I mean, bishop g2 is just the natural move, but I'm thinking about c4, d takes c4, d5, knight b4, knight c3. I feel like I have a strong initiative there. And now that he's played g6, it's awkward. Like, he doesn't really want to go e6 anymore. It wouldn't really fit in with his development scheme, I think. And the thing I like about playing c4 now, by the way, is that if I go bishop g2, bishop g7, c4, d takes c4, d5 can be met by knight e5, because now the bishop controls the e5 square. So I'm going to play this. I'm going to play c4 now and ask him the question, because obviously allowing... Okay, so he's just going to go e6. And that's fine. It's just... This is just kind of a weird setup for black. It's not that common to mix e6 and g6 because it leaves a lot of weak squares. And again, what are you doing with this thing? So now if I castle, d takes c4, queen a4, let's say... Complicated, but I doubt it's bad. So we'll go castles. He'll probably go knight g to e7 is my guess. Unless he really... Nope. This guy... You can't peg this guy down. Original opening variation from cplyakap1905. So if I go knight c3 now, this is the only annoying thing about these positions is I really want him to take on c4 in principle because I like having these center pawns, but I also have to make sure that they're not, like, losing for me. So if I go knight c3, d takes c4, he here. Yeah, I think that's fine. So I'll go knight c3. Not sure where I want to put this bishop yet. If he castles... Castles bishop g5, h6. What am I doing there? Bishop takes, bishop takes. C takes d5, e takes d5. Nothing super exciting there. It's sort of, am I going to put the bishop here or here? And if I'm putting it here, so he's going for it. Now the question is, do I go just e4 or queen a4 is my initial thought. Of course, pinning the knight so he can't take on d4, and I'm just going to play queen takes c4. And then long term, I have two center pawns, and black has to figure out what to do about this bishop. Is there anything wrong with this? I don't think so. I'm just going to play queen a4 quickly. I mean, black should castle, but yeah, if he's silly enough not to castle, knight e5 would be a pretty serious threat. So we'll go here. Perhaps knight d5 is kind of thematic. Swinging the knight over to b6, uncovering the bishop. I think, yeah. My initial thought is just rook d1. But perhaps I have to... I don't want to really play e3 if I don't have to. But knight b6... kind of annoying. So... rook d1, knight b6, queen b3, knight d4. That doesn't really work. I can play knight takes d4, bishop takes d4, whoops, e3, exploiting the pin. So that's possible. I sort of feel like b3 is the correct square for my queen. I don't know why. Like, I could go back to d3, like, for instance, rook d1, knight b6, queen d3, knight b4, queen b1, then I kick it back out with a3. That's possible. I'm not sure which one is better. Not sure if it matters much. Yeah, I'll go rook d1, and I think if he plays knight b6, I'll probably play just queen b3. I can go queen c5 also, actually, now that I think about it. Interesting option. I'm not sure if it's better or worse than... queen b3. Thing I like about queen b3 is in this structure, it's sort of the plan to just try and bust black open with d5. I mean, that's the... oh, wow. I did not expect that move. So I'm going to take back with the b pawn. Strengthen my center. Queen d5. Almost certainly not trading. Maybe queen b3 I would accept a trade, but I think queen d3 is just... queen d3, e5 might be his idea, but then I can just play knight takes e5. No? You can't play knight takes d5 in that position, though. Interesting. Maybe it's... this move is not as silly as I thought. Certainly unorthodox. If queen d3, e5, knight takes e5, knight takes e5... bishop takes d5, knight takes d3, rook takes d3. Mess. I can also play e takes d3, I guess. I find it really hard to believe that this is like a legitimate way to play. Just lining up your queen here. But what do I do? I can play queen a4 too. Queen a4, bishop d7. Knight e5, that, man, but then somehow knight e5 again. So I'm always, somehow I'm running into problems with my queen and all of these variations with knight discoveries. It's weird. I just, like, queen b3, a takes b3 would be a perfectly pleasant position for me, but I somehow don't feel like that's the maximalist approach. I mean, the question is, if queen d3, am I just up a pawn after e5, knight takes e5? or what's really happening there. I think I kind of like the looks of queen d3. If e5, knight takes e5, knight takes e5, d takes e5. No, queen d3, e5, knight takes e5, knight takes e5, bishop takes d5, knight takes d3, perhaps e takes d3. So if bishop takes d5, then I can play d4 again. And I think black's going to have some problems with pressure on his queen side, because now my bishop is open. I can go rook a to b1, perhaps bishop f4. Hit this guy. So I think I'm gonna do this. I just somehow don't feel like just going queen b3 and allowing queen takes b3. That looks good. I'm not sure it's the best I can do though. Like now black has to watch out for these things. He's, you know, gotta watch out for knight discovery somehow, and this just feels a little bit better. So he's gonna go for this, and I'm gonna play knight takes e5 quick. That is the most obvious move. And I'll go in for this. I did have a slight visualization problem here, though. I thought my pawn was on e5, and so after bishop takes e5, I'd go d4 again. So let me. I kind of screwed this up, but only in my head. I'm not losing material. I just calculated wrong. Okay, I feel like bishop takes d5 is the move. And now I have to decide whether or not I want to take with the e-pawn or with the rook. Taking with the e-pawn looks weird, but I'm not even sure that's really all that bad. I kind of like it. He's presumably going c6 almost no matter what. And yeah, I don't, I kind of, yeah, is this pawn going to be weak though after bishop f5? In a lot of cases, maybe. If I play rook d3, I just don't know. This is weird. I'm going to give this a whirl. I'm going to try this. This might turn out to be a mistake later. We'll have to look at it. Interesting. Presumably c6, and I have to retrieve my bishop somewhere. Oh, no. I don't know. I haven't been able to predict a single move of this guy the entire time. The wild man. Not even sure d takes c5 is really that bad. Bishop takes c3, rook b1. He's got problems. This c pawn could turn out to be a real asset, actually. And yeah, I mean, otherwise he's taking here, so what else? All right, so we'll place d takes c5 and then rook b1. You guys will notice I'm trying to be at least slightly quicker in this video. I've been running into some time trouble problems. I think having to commentate is while you're playing is harder than I thought it would be. And yeah, I don't want it to, you know, it's not fun to watch commentated games and invest your time in watching my videos if I play really poorly because I have to commentate. So you got to strike that balance somehow. And I'm working on it. I'm probably like 1600 at commentating on my games right now. Which is only slightly lower than my actual rating. No, I'm just kidding. But seriously, though. I have dinner plans at 6:30. I'm going to a restaurant called Tommy's. Oh, interesting. Presumably his idea is bishop b7, rook b8. Pinning me. I can go c6 there, though. I don't know if you saw that. Or if he cares. And so bishop b7. Sorry, sometimes I take my hands off the mouse and I just announce the moves. I should. Bishop b7, rook b7. I'm just simply up two pawns. Bishop b7, rook b8 is his idea, but I think this seems kind of good. Because now that the bishop's protected, bishop f4 would be a very large threat there. And it's not easy to see how he's going to avoid such things. So bishop b7, rook b8, c6, rook d6. What does that do even? Rook d6, bishop. I'm trying to, black can play rook c6 is my point, because if bishop c6, then rook takes b1 again. But that doesn't actually work if I play bishop f4, because then my rook is not pinned anymore. So I just think this is good, right? Rook b8, c6, bishop b7. Okay, so he can play bishop b7, rook b8, c6, bishop takes. C takes, rook d7. And I can't stop him from winning his pawn back. But I can play bishop takes b7, rook b8, c6, bishop takes b7, rook takes b7. And then if rook takes b7, c takes b7, rook b8, rook c1. No, rook c1's impossible. My bishop is still not. So what do I do? Feel like this is a critical moment. Obviously, if I can take on b7, he's just losing. So I feel like I have to be precise here, and if I'm precise here, he's in a lot of trouble. So if rook b8, c6, bishop takes b7. Bishop takes b7, c6. Oh, I have c7. C7 is an option with the fork. So maybe this works. I mean, worst case scenario, I just have to give the pawn back. All right, I'm going to take this. Not waste any time. This guy plays extremely fast. And I'll pre-move this. Wow, he doesn't even want it. Okay. That happens sometimes. You waste all this time on analyzing some move, and then they just don't even remotely go into any of it. So I think I'm pretty happy to go into a rook ending two pawns up here with my rook on the seventh. So I'll just play bishop e3. I'm happy if he trades. I'd have a massive pass central pawns that. Okay. One idea is to go bishop takes d4, rook takes d4, rook e1, planning to invade on the 7th. Also just take on a7. He takes on c5, and that's fine too. I think I'm just going to gobble this guy up. I don't see a way to really protect my c-pawn so much. I can go rook c1, but then bishop takes, f takes, rook takes d3. I'm not sure about that. So I'm just going to gobble up this a-pawn, and then I think I'm going to try and get this guy to this square and in some fashion or another, rook e1 or whatever. Okay, so guess I'll take here. And do I just hang this pawn immediately? That doesn't really look that bad. I can go d4. A4 even, I can get the A-pawn rolling. How do I win this? I actually have no idea what the best way to win this is. What I don't want to happen is him to win this and then me just having the A-pawn. Those endings are sometimes hard to win. Can play king F1. Play d4, rook c to d5, rook a4. My rook is awfully passive, though, is the problem. Okay, I'm just going to play a4. I don't know if that's the best move. Rook c to d5. Okay, I think I actually just have to go into this. So I'll pre-move this. These endings are sometimes winning when the rook, when the pawn is not on a7 yet. So we'll see how this goes. So, play king f1. The winning plan is you got to get your king somewhere over here. And a lot of times that involves the king making it to b2. King g7, sure. So if I play king d1 now, rook f2, rook b7. I'm going to play h4. At some point, I need to play king d1, but it's kind of tricky because I think if I played king d1 right now, it would hang the h2 pawn as well. So now if I go king d1, rook f2, rook b7, rook a2, a7, I don't have a lot of time, king c1. Or like king f6, king c1, king e6, king b1, rook a6, let's say. Ugh, no time. Okay, I'll just go for this, and we'll see how it goes. Takes on f2, rook b7, yeah, rook a2, a7. Now I'm going to get my king. I'm going to try and get my king to some square, you know, far advanced square, release my rook from having to protect this pawn, and then usher this pawn into a8. And hope the issue is that black a lot of times ends up winning another one of these pawns, and I've studied these rook endings in some detail. My king is just gonna walk all the way up now. Oh god, it's my turn. I didn't see him make a move. Holy god. Pay attention. One trick he needs to watch out for is like if he goes rook a6, I can play. Well, not now, because rook b6, rook takes b6 would be check on my king, but rook b6, like if he goes rook a6, I can play rook b6 check and deflect his king away. So I'm going to go rook king b4 first. Don't think it much matters. Oh man, I could have taken. Oh, maybe that doesn't matter. Again, I was looking at rook b5 like tactics. Play king c5. He was threatening to check perhaps. He really wasn't though. I'll pre-move this capture. And again, I'm just going to walk my king to essentially b8 in this position, and then he has to find a way to like, you know, get... that move probably wasn't the best. So, oops, that move would be bad. The thing I have to watch out for is this is a rook pawn, so... I might be bungling this already. I might have already screwed it up, but I essentially can't lose this. Yeah, and I will go make the queen. I don't think I can win this. I think his pawn is too far. Oh my god, I almost flagged. All right, I'm just going to take that thing before I flag. Jeez, Tony, that was too close. I had like a fraction of a second left. Okay, what a mess that game was. Jeez. All right. So let's analyze this game first, and then we'll go back and analyze the first one, which was a little bit cleaner of an affair. So Oh, you guys are going to spoil it. See, this is the problem with using Lee Chess, is other people can request a computer analysis of your games, and then we're going to find out everything before the action happens. So, yeah, this is used by people who like to play the Chigorin's defense against d4, so how bad did I play? Not that bad. I bungled the win, of course, but but I was never in any trouble, so that's good. Yeah, like I said, knight f3, knight c6 is used by people who like to meet d4, d5, c4 with knight c6. This is called the Chigorin's defense, and it does break the cardinal rule that, in general, you don't want to block your c-pawn with the knight in queen's pawn openings. A lot of times in the queen's pawn openings, like, for instance, 2c4, since c4 does not really weaken white's king, like the way the king's gambit would weaken white's king. So, for instance, fighting against the center with a flank pawn in this case is somewhat risky because moving the f-pawn has more dire consequences. But in the queen's pawn openings, white can play c2, c4 and fight for the central squares with a flank pawn, and it's usually only good to play your knight to c3 after you've put your pawn on c5. So, the Chigorin's defense does break that rule, but this opening does make it a little bit easier for black to break in the center with e5 compared to a lot of the other queen's gambit positions. And in general, black is looking for some non-standard kind of interesting positions for following something like, you know, bishop g4 here or e5. Yeah, a favorite of Alexander Morozevich. He wrote a book on Chigorin's defense with Vladimir Barsky in probably like the early 2000s. Of course, black, if he's going to play this, also has to be prepared for e4 when e5 would bring us back to king's pawn openings, of course. But black also tries other stuff here, for instance, d6. Or then after d4, I've seen some people go knight f6, etc. Interesting lines, but I was happy to just go d4, d5. And then I kind of like playing g3 here just because I like being that guy who doesn't give people what they want. So I know he wants to play a Chigorin's defense and, you know, maybe take on c4, or I actually don't know what the theory is there, but yeah. So I just go g3 and delay c4 for at least a move or two. But g6 is completely non-standard here. I mean, I don't know anything about the position now. But like I said, I did play c4 now with the point that d takes c4, d5, the knight cannot swing into the e5 square in this position and would have to either go back or go to a5 or b4, for instance, which are not as comfortable. But he protected with e6, probably the best move. And after bishop g2, bishop g7, castles, knight f6. I sort of felt like this was maybe a more logical development of the knight, but what do I know? Just not blocking the bishop, of course, and maybe a pin with bishop g5 is a little less severe with the knight on e7. But I don't know. Knight f6, you know, all things considered, is not a bad move either. He took on c4, which is kind of surprising. I feel like if you're going to take on c4, maybe you should do it before you block your light squared bishop in with e6, but yeah, and here I couldn't decide between e4 or queen a4. Queen a4 is the safer move because I know I'm getting my pawn back, but e4 is also possible. It looks kind of good. I mean, white will have long-term compensation even if he doesn't get his pawn back right away for a long time, just because it's not easy for black to get his pieces active with this bishop locked in on c8 and this rook on a8, and white has this preponderance of pawns in the center. I mean, I almost even want to go like just b3 here, and when he takes, take on b3 again. This is pretty common, and then my rook is active. He has no central presence whatsoever. I think white would have reasonable compensation in this position. But it didn't feel necessary for me to do that, so. And knight d5, this is really a very thematic idea when black takes d takes c4 and the queen ends up on c4. You see it in the Grunfeld all the time. And black wants to reposition his knight to b6, where it looks at the possibly weak c4 square. It opens up this bishop, and so on. So this is probably a good move. And I went rook d1. It's also possible to go e3 here, like I said, just reacting to knight b6 with the threat on the queen and the d-pawn in the most solid way humanly possible. And, you know, you can then drop your queen back to the e2 square, play rook d1, and then slowly prepare e4. But, again, I wanted to play this in the most maximalist way possible, and I think rook d1, preparing to go e4 in one move and putting this rook on a more active square right away and not blocking in this dark-squared bishop. e3, you know, it might be hard to get this piece into the game for a long time. And I'm sort of pot-committed now that I've kind of criticized black for playing e5 and blocking this bishop, and so I can't play e3 and block my own bishop. That would just be hypocritical. So, knight c3, though, this feels like a concession to me. I feel like black should go knight b6, and I was planning on going queen b3 with the tactical point that I'm picking up the bishop after e3 utilizing this pin. So, yeah, and this would be the most Grunfeld-esque way to play, I think, is playing a5 and possibly going a4, just gaining maximal amount of space on the queen side. Maybe you're going to go knight a5. One of these knights can come into c4 then when the pawn's on a4. Maybe down the road a3 is kind of an irritating idea. This is kind of an interesting position, because if e4, then I lose the option of attacking the pin piece. So I wonder if this, yeah, he can take now, because, I mean, I can go bishop e3, but it's not all that exciting if he can go e5 and takes, knight b5 maybe. Oh, yeah, he can go c5. So that would... I didn't see that when I was analyzing, but yeah. Maybe putting the queen on d3, or... Yeah, I mentioned c5 in passing. Maybe, like, this square was better. Yeah, I looked at this. Just, I think I'm fine going to b1, and a3 is coming. Maybe this is actually the best way to play. I don't know. Interesting. But knight takes c3 felt a little awkward to me. It doesn't seem like a great idea for white it doesn't feel like a good idea for black to allow white to shore up his d4 pawn and open up the b-file. And queen d5 again felt kind of weird, just exposing yourself along this diagonal. But it wasn't easy for me to find an outright refutation. Yeah, like queen b3 I thought is fine, but I wasn't super excited about playing this queenless middle game when I thought maybe I had more. Like, what if just rook d8? Oh yeah, I guess bishop f4 is an annoying threat in all of these variations that I didn't consider all that much. But e5, yeah, I assumed I could just meet e5 with d4 though, or e5 with d5, and I'd be quite a bit more comfortable. Yeah, this can't be good for black. So that's an option, yeah. Queen d3. I think e5 is the critical move. And after this, I can also take here. But again, yeah, he can take, or he can take here. This is kind of like what I was talking about before. I think this has to be slightly better for white as well. And if bishop g7, the pressure on black's queen side starts mounting pretty quickly. Finds it hard to develop. It feels like white's two bishops are better than black's two bishops. But yeah, a queen takes e5 is quite a bit better, and then white has to figure out what he's doing about this c-pawn. So I took here, takes here, and now the question is if one of these captures is better than the other. Doesn't seem like it matters that much. For instance, if I just move this bishop. He can't go bishop f5, which I missed because of e4. Definitely missing some stuff in this game, but I assume c6 would be played here, just, and after bishop d2 or bishop, probably bishop f3 is better to stop bishop g4 from harassing this rook. I was a little bit worried about this, just because eventually this rook is not the finest piece on d1, So this was my reservation with playing E takes D3, is I wasn't sure if I was ever going to be able to relieve the rook of guard duty without just simply losing this pawn. I mean, yeah, this is... But yeah, then again, I mean, what does black do about this threat to the B pawn also? Because rook B8, bishop F4 would be curtains. So he has to go B5, but that hangs, you know, a bunch of extra material, so... But that's sort of also the case in these lines, for instance. I mean, this is not really any different with regards to the B-pawn. I'm always going to go rook A to B1. Yeah, and after this, it almost feels like, after these forced moves, it almost feels like, at least after rook D8, that black is in some trouble, because either he missed this, or he just wanted to get active, and he felt like he couldn't waste the time defending the B-pawn, but... So rook b8 was the line that I looked at, and then c6. And yeah, the thing I didn't find until much later is that c7 is a very serious threat. So I thought about... I was agonizing over this position, looking at, like, this capture, then rook d7. You know, this wasn't super exciting because black is taking on b7, or similarly, just this, when, again, I can't protect b7. But... Yeah, once I saw C7, I know that this is totally game over. Because I think I'm probably winning this bishop too. For instance, yeah, like the computer's move, whatever, bishop F6, I can just take this thing, and then bishop F4. And if he moves the rook, I take on B7. So that would be extremely bad. And so, yeah, I mean, maybe he didn't think about it very long, but probably bishop B7 was forced. And after rook B7... Black is active, like that. The problem with this position is I'm up two pawns, but they're both weak, and black's rooks come to pretty good squares pretty quickly. Yeah, looks like the computer thinks bishop e3 was an inaccuracy. I didn't think I could really defend the pawn all that well after this, though. Even c7 and then here, but I guess, yeah, I have bishop f4. If here... Ah, rook b8. And this rook is unfortunately placed to back up his brother on c8. Yeah, dang it, Tony. Missed this one for sure. And this was a critical moment, but again, I was just left with, like, not that much time to figure it out. And so I saw bishop e3. I figured I have to develop. You know, you need to calculate a while when you play a move like c6. To make sure that it's not just, like, hanging the c6 pawn, and I didn't really have the time to evaluate much further than, you know, this, and I was like, okay, maybe, you know, this position he's getting the pawn back, but I missed rook b8. So bishop e3, not best. Rook a to c8, yeah. My opponent defended well. I mean, from this point on, it wasn't... Like, it seemed like he played all of the best moves. He stayed active. He got into a rook endgame that's sort of notoriously tricky to win. It's kind of tricky to defend, too. I mean, I have an A-pawn, and he doesn't have anything. So, playing for one result, but it's not that easy. Especially not easy would be something like this. Like, a lot of people make the mistake of putting this pawn on A7 too soon. And this ending is just a theoretical draw. So... Computers say it's plus 1.3, but white can't actually make any progress. The problem is that there's nowhere for white's king to hide. Anywhere, any one of these squares that would kind of, like especially these squares that would protect the pawn and allow me to free my rook. At any time I hit one of these squares, black's rook will just check, and I have to move away from the pawn. You know, imagine my king was here, he checks, I have to go here, then he can go back. And again, tie this rook to the defense of the pawn. And of course, anytime I move my rook, he's just going to take this thing. So the only way you can really lose this position as black is if you allow some tactical trick where white gets to move his rook and play a8. Like, for instance, the most common one, I'll just, like, play a bunch of moves that are stupid that don't make any sense, but that would illustrate the trap, is like f5, king g2, king h7. And the general rule in these, like, rook pawn... on the seventh single rook endings like this, is that your king, black's king, when the pawn is on a7, should stay on g7 or h7. because the moment you can see, hold on, let me go back to that variation. The moment it comes to f7, you allow this cheap tactic with rook here. And if rook takes, then I skewer you and win your rook. And if you don't do anything, of course, I'm just playing a8 and I'm winning your rook anyway, so. The only way white can win these endings is if he has a second pawn, it can create like a second passed pawn somehow. And in 3 versus 3, it's usually very difficult. And I think even a G and an H pawn, even if it's extra, like for instance, if like this pawn was gone, this pawn was gone, this pawn was gone, and I just had like this pawn left, for instance, this H pawn, that's actually still a draw as well. I was thinking about making a video actually about these single rook, extra rook pawn endings, because I enjoy studying them and I think it's a very practical endgame. So maybe I'll talk a little bit more about it. Then the mate, typically if you want to try to win this with white, I think it's better to keep the pawn on a6. That gives your king, the a7 square, and then you can try and rearrange, free up your rook to, more active posts that can block the checks from your king, from the rook, for instance. Really, you want your king on like b8, the rook on b7, and then you can just escort your pawn to a8. But as happened in the game, you can see, in order to activate the king and make it past the rook, you have to put your king on some like ridiculously far away square, like b2. And when you do that, black has a move or two to munch on, you know, one of these pawns, and then a lot of times he can activate his king, and what ends up happening is you get, black will sack this rook for the pawn, and you get this rook versus like, you know, one or two of these, or two or three of these pawns, and you have to try and win that. So a lot of times it's not that easy. And yeah, I didn't want to play king d1 here because I thought rook f2, rook b7, rook takes h2. And if a7, black still gets back in time. And then this is quite a bit, this 3 versus 1 is quite a bit easier for black to drum up almost winning chances, or at least not losing chances when I don't have two pawns here. So I played h4 first just to stop rook f2, and then rook takes h2. He played h5. I think that's a good move. King d1. Yeah, computers might suggest some other stuff here, but I'm not sure if any of it actually wins. So like rook a8, king f6, a7, and what if I just go back? Like what is black's plan? White's winning plan. So it wants to go f3. Let's just say I just keep doing this. King d1. King c1. This might be a good illustration of the fact that black simply, or like white simply cannot win this. Like let's just say I just keep doing this. I let his king get all the way to where it wants to go. I'll just put my rook back on a2. The moment he goes here, I check him. Yeah, he has to go back. I check him again. And of course, the checks don't stop until he heads back to some really pathetic square, and then I just go rook a2 again. So you have to be careful in some of these theoretical endgames that you don't get too swayed by the +2.5 or whatever of the computers. A lot of times they're just not really sure. So maybe this is just a draw all along. Like maybe black played okay and just drew. I think if I'm going to try and win this, I essentially have to sack a pawn here. I could try and play like f3, but rook a3 would, king e2 would lead to similar. Eventually I'm gonna have to put my king on b2 to kick his rook away from blocking me along the third rank to get my king up here, and then he's just gonna take one of these guys. So I'm not sure if I was ever winning. Yeah, and white's point is that the rook is a little bit better on b7 than it is on like a8 in this variation, so my king can head over here now. So 3.5 is sort of where, okay, so now I'm probably winning, but I don't know where I bungled it. So h takes g, oh dang, yeah, there's a tactic here. So h takes g5, if king takes g5, I have check and then rook a5 and he's losing. Yeah, that is a common theme in this ending as well, that black needs to be careful with his king position when the rook is on this b7 square. White's made the switcheroo from having the rook behind to the rook on the side, is that this check and flip over is a very common motif, and I missed it. You know, it's sad. I've even studied these endgames. I mean, I've seen these themes before, but yeah, with only a couple seconds on your clock and me not having looked at it in a long time, I just didn't see it. So yeah, h takes g5 was completely decisive, most likely. If here, I can go king b5, and I'm threatening the same trick. He must take now, but then he hangs a pawn, and this will be... I don't think he probably can win this pawn without me just making a queen, so I think I'm probably just going to win a rook up ending in this case. Yeah, but after this... See, this is why endgames are so crazy. Like, king b5, apparently, plus 4. King b6, draw. So why is that? Maybe pause your video if you want. And I have the engine on, but we can take this as a quiz. So king b5, king takes h4. Oh, so king b5, king takes h4 is the same theme. Rook f4 and then rook a4, presumably. So he can't take my extra pawn yet after king b5. But if I go king b6, he can take because I can't, my rook is unprotected. So subtle. So yeah, if here, then this check and this wins. So what if he just goes like king g3, let's say? Oh, so this is another case of the engine thinking it's winning when it's not. So I go king b5. And now it thinks it's plus one. God, I'm just going to turn this thing off. It's useless. Yeah, I think this is actually probably just a draw. Like, all the way, most likely. I mean, I think this position is a theoretical draw. And I don't think black did anything to give me actual winning chances besides this moment. So there's this moment right here where I could have taken on g5. And I think I'm legitimately winning because of this. But after I bungle that opportunity, I think it's probably just a draw. But yeah, this is a good impetus for me to, again, make some videos and restudy these endings, because I think they're really interesting, and I think they come up quite a bit as far as practical rook endings go. Okay, so that was that game. Let's go to the other game. Quite a bit more successful. And we'll analyze this one instead. Yeah, and there was just really that one moment, honestly. So d4, knight f6, c4, g6, d5. This is the Grunfeld defense. Instead, bishop g7 allows e4. And then, of course, because of this, black is kind of forced to play d6. And this is the King's Indian defense, which I played a lot. But I'm trying to get out of it, so... Played the Grunfeld defense, and the main point, if you guys aren't familiar with the theory, is that c takes d5, knight takes d5, e4, knight takes c3, b takes c3. Yes, white gets to set up this bolstered center, but after bishop g7, black's going to play c5 and start trying to knock down this center with basically all of their might. The queen hits d4, the bishop hits d4, the c5 pawn hits d4, frequently the knight comes to c6, that hits d4. If a knight comes to f3, bishop g5 will pin and indirectly influence d4. So, and the main problem is that d5 would right now lose a massive amount of material to bishop takes c3. But in general, white has to work a little bit hard to be able to play, you know, d5, c4, etc. because of this rook and this pawn. So that would be what I would expect. White is not forced to take on d5. Knight f3 is a perfectly reasonable move, and after bishop g7, there are a lot of options. Bishop f4 is a move. Bishop g5 is a move. Queen b3 is a move called the Russian system. Those are the big ones. Even e3 is possible, but that's kind of lame. Or again, white could go back into the exchange variation, where he's just inserted knight f3 and bishop g7. And this, at least for a long time, was sort of the main theoretical battleground in the Grunfeld defense after c5 and then rook b1. With rook b1, white removes the pin and discourages bishop g4 on account of rook takes b7. Those are two of the biggest points. It is a pawn sacrifice, though, because after this, check, bishop d2, black can take on a2. But white gets a large lead in development, and black's queen on a2 is kind of stupid. It's got the big center, so... At some point, I want to do some videos on the Grunfeld because it'll encourage me to study it a little bit deeper, but yeah. Whoops. Knight takes d5 is decidedly non-standard. I'm not a big fan of this move. The problem is that now that you've exchanged off the knight that normally comes to c3, my queen is very stable on this well-centralized square. And as we saw in the game, it's not easy for white to deal with the pressure on d4 already. So castles, knight c6, bishop g4 are all coming. And yeah, and probably d takes c5 is a mistake. I can take here, and I think black is still totally fine. You know, I don't know what the best move is for white here. Bishop d3 or bishop e2, perhaps. Let's just say bishop d3. Castles, knight c6. I mean, black has literally no problems. In fact, black's probably a little bit better here, even. I like, a lot of times, if white doesn't get this piece out of the gates too soon and the center opens up, this bishop is just a total beast. And all of my pieces are coming to very active squares. My rooks have really great open lines. My bishops will both be very active. My queen isn't weak here because this e3 pawn really impedes the dark squared bishop. And yeah, it's just really comfortable for black. So queen takes c5 might be equally as good without any real risk. Because again, yeah, black's queen just kind of gets trapped on these open files, and the bishop exerts kind of awkward pressure on b2, so. I can go knight d7 here, but I didn't feel like I needed to give white the option of something like this. Even here, I didn't realize that bishop d2 could be met with bishop takes b2 until too late, but yeah, I was concerned about bishop d2 specifically here when he can go rook c1, but yeah, it's not a concern at all. Black is much better here too. So yeah, I mean, this probably might have even been better, but I just decided to castle and avoid this bishop b5 nonsense. And knight d4, yeah, I think this move is probably just bad. Probably just an inaccuracy. White has too many problems to solve for him to be moving an opening piece in the opening twice. Yeah, I think just he has to focus on getting his king out of dodge here, because otherwise this thing just gets... I mean, you saw it in the game. It just gets caught in the crossfire. And rook d8. I think I mentioned knight c6 as even being possible. And after takes, again, like, black's pieces are just coming to like ridiculously good squares. And the problem with dislodging your king is it you can never really easily fix it. Like, to get this king into safety is going to take a long time and a lot of effort, and you can't, it's just it wasn't feasible in this game. Yeah, and there are even moves other than knight c6, but I think knight c6 is the most energetic and ambitious move. So I could take back the pawn, but I didn't want to give up this very strong bishop just to regain material equality. Yeah, like king c2 and then bishop c3, maybe bishop d3, and white might be able to complete his development and restore the balance. Whereas after something like this, the threats are starting to look a little bit overwhelming. Like bishop takes b2, rook b1, bishop c3 is a thing. Rook b8, rook takes b2 is a thing when it's not easy to play b3, and white can't play rook b1 particularly easily because of this, and where's this piece going? It's just, yeah, just tons of practical problems here, and yeah, this just fails to a tactic, which I mentioned during the video. And now black's up a pawn, and still, again, the problem with having king safety problems is they don't easily go away. So I won my pawn back, but I'm still kind of bringing the pain here. There's no real way to solve black's or white's problems here. G2 and A2 are both still weak. It's rough. Yeah, and then bishop C4 just loses immediately, I think. So I looked at king B3, rook B8, king A3, rook takes C4, and yeah. I mean, white honestly has to be very careful to just not get mated here, even because of this rook restricting the movement, but also just that move would be a serious mistake, yeah. Or just this, here, and takes. Yeah, this would be problems too. And in fact, this is almost a mating net because Black's king is cut off. That's kind of funny. So yeah, two interesting games. A little mini match against CPL Yakup 1905. Whatever the heck that means. A nice quick win in the Grunfeld, and then a tough game that probably I should look at more in detail and try to figure out if I can secure some winning chances in that rook end game. Quite a bit harder. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed the games. I hope you guys are enjoying the channel so far. This will probably be the last classical video for maybe a couple days. I need to finish up the Reddit opening of the week analysis, and I know that I'll be traveling this weekend, so it'll be unlikely that I'll record any videos over the weekend, at least until Sunday afternoon when I get back. And I also want to do some instructional stuff, like tactic solving, I think would be nice. I want to work a little bit more on my calculation, and I'll probably record all that, let you guys in on the fun, sense the sarcasm there. But yeah, hope you guys had a great Monday, and I'll see you guys later. Bye.